Okay, good afternoon and welcome everybody. Thanks for joining us today. It's good to see familiar faces. Welcome to those who are joining us online as well. My name is Antoine Halff. I'm the director of the Global Oil Markets Program here at the Columbia University Center on Global Energy Policy. And tonight, this afternoon, we're going to talk about a topic that's been very much in the headlines in recent weeks, even more than usual, Venezuela, where the oil crisis has been, which has been brewing for quite a while, has metastasized into a full-blown humanitarian crisis. Shelves are empty, hospitals are running out of medicine, malaria is coming back as a major epidemic, political opposition to the regime is on the rise, and the oil outlook is very uncertain. Given the glut in oil markets today, I think the oil market is taking all of this in stride until now. But things could change, and certainly financial markets are watching the Venezuelan debt very closely, as developments yesterday and today clearly show. Just recently, the Center released an important report by Luisa Palacios about the outlook for oil, the oil sector and oil production in the country. We're going to debate this report tonight. Luisa will present some of her findings, and we have a very distinguished panel that will then engage in discussion and also take questions from the audience. I will introduce the panelists just in a second, but before I do that, I would like to quickly say that this event, like all the other similar events we do at the center, is being webcast live. There will be a full video and a podcast recording available on our website and iTunes in just a few days. And for those of you watching online, you will have the opportunity to ask questions to the panelists at any time using our hashtag at Columbia University, CGP events, and our Twitter handle at Columbia U Energy. People in the audience also can walk up to the microphone that will be in place to ask questions. So tonight our speakers happen to be all either Columbia grads or faculty or fellows. So let me start with Luisa Palacios. She's a fellow here at the Center on Global Energy Policy and a CIPA master's as well. Currently, she's the head of Latin America Energy and Analysis in general at Medley Advisors, the consultancy in New York. She has a very long experience in the financial sector in various capacities. She's worked with Barclays as a strategist for the Andean region on the emerging markets fixed income desk. She's worked at JBIC, the Japan Bank for International Cooperation, as a senior economist at the Société Générale Bank in Paris and here in New York. And she's been a consultant at the World Bank in the Office of Chief Economist for Latin America. She's she's also a Venezuelan originally and an adjunct professor at the Center for Energy Studies at AIESA in Caracas. Adrian Lajous, to my left, immediately to my left, is best known as a non-resident fellow at the Center, but earlier in his career also was the CEO of PEMEX, the Mexican national oil company. He's a Renaissance man in the best Mexican tradition. He's both a scholar and an industry leader. He started his career at El Colegio de Mexico in the 1970s, then moved to the Ministry of Energy, where he promptly became a director general. And then he moved on to PEMEX in the late 80s, where he became CEO in the second half of the 90s. After leaving public service after 30 years. He served as a senior advisor of McKinsey. He's been on the board of many companies, Repsol, YPF, Tenaris, and many others. And he's continued his academic career as well. He's been a senior fellow at the Kennedy school at Harvard. He's been the chair of the Oxford Institute for Energy Studies for many years, the chair of the Oxford Energy Policy Club as well, and the chairman of the Colloquio de Política Energética, forgive my accent, in Mexico City. And he has degrees from the University of Mexico as well as Cambridge. And Chris Sabatini is also a faculty at the School of International and Public Affairs at Columbia, a lecturer on international relations, as well as the founder and executive director of Global Americans, which is a research nonprofit. And he's the editor of its news and opinion website, LatinAmericaGoesGlobal.org. I won't give you a full bio, but he's been a senior director of policy at the America Society, leading work on the rule of law and on Cuba. He founded America's Quarterly in 2007 and serves as its editor-in-chief. It's a magazine devoted to the hemisphere. And he's been a director for Latin America and the Caribbean at the National Endowment for Democracy from 1997 to 2005. And we had another speaker, Alejandro Arriaza, but unfortunately, because of development in the Venezuelan bond markets the last 2 days, he's unable to join us tonight. So again, before we start the event, just as a quick reminder, my name, for those of us who follow us online or listen to the podcast, my name is Antoine Halff. I'm here with Luisa Palacios of Medley Advisors, Adrian Lajous of the Center on Global Energy Policy and former head of PEMEX, and Chris Sabatini, lecturer on international affairs at the School of International and Public Affairs at Columbia, and the founder and editor-in-chief of America's Quarterly. So we're discussing tonight the current crisis in Venezuela with special focus on the oil sector and the outlook for production in the country. We have a conversation here among the panelists, and then we'll open it up to questions from the audience in a bit. For those of you here in person, please come up to the microphone to ask questions when you wish. For those watching online, again, you can use our hashtag CGPEvents and our Twitter handle at ColombiaUEnergy to ask a question. Thank you. So let me turn it over to Luisa.
Should I?
Yeah, sure.
Perfect. Thank you, Antoine, for that kind introduction, and thank you to the Center for organizing this event. I am Venezuelan, don't hold that against me, but this is a subject that is very dear to my heart. As Antoine was mentioning, Venezuela is in the midst of a unprecedented economic, political, financial crisis, and it's taking a significant toll as well on the oil sector. Just last week, OPEC released its monthly monitor, where it showed that Venezuela's oil production declined by 12% year on year, which is equivalent to a 320,000 barrels per day decline. Year to date, Venezuela's oil production has fallen by about 240,000 barrels per day. It's very clear to me that that Venezuela is. Venezuela is the clear non-performer in OPEC, all of which are actually increasing oil production. And those that are actually having declines in oil production is because they're in the middle of a civil war or a civil unrest of massive proportions. So Venezuela is up there. Actually, its numbers on August were one of the worst among the OPEC members. What I would say is that the declines in oil production have yet, or the oil market has yet to completely see or feel the significant declines that we're seeing in Venezuela's oil production. And part of that has to do with the fact that Venezuela is in the middle of an economic freefall, with significant declines in output last year, projections that Venezuela is going to decline by 10% this year. That has meant as well that oil demand in Venezuela is declining significantly. Last year, for example, PDVSA, in its financial reports, had oil demand in Venezuela declining by more than 100,000 barrels per day. I would expect that we will see similar declines in oil demand this year, if not much more. So what has happened is that while oil production is declining rapidly in Venezuela, the oil markets have yet to feel or have not yet felt that in a very significant way because the oil demand is cushioning somewhat that impact. But what I'm starting to see using tanker data is that is starting to change and rapidly. The U.S., for example, just released its August oil imports numbers, and Venezuela's oil exports to the U.S. Fell by about 12-13% year-on-year in August. August was a significant number last year, but still, you're starting to see that percolate into Venezuela's most important oil partners. If we look at the tanker data, what it's showing is that while Q1 export numbers did not see significant declines in oil exports, you are starting to see that in Q2 and from Q2 onwards. The most important month was really May. May, Venezuela saw a decline of 120,000 barrels per day, month-on-month production, pretty much due to the very significant impact that the electricity crisis had on oil production. But after that, the oil production did not recover but continued to decline, and it has now translated into oil exports. So when we look at June, July, and August tanker data from Venezuela, what we see is that on average, oil exports in Venezuela are down about 250 to 300,000 barrels per day from 2015 averages. So you are starting to see those numbers being impacted. I normally use the Jose Terminal exports as the best indicator, just because the Jose Terminal represents 70% of Venezuela's total exports. It is where the marginal barrel of oil is coming from, and it's where the best data is found. And you can see the same numbers. The red line is the averages of 2015, and then you get the numbers from June, July, and August, again showing that Venezuela should be somewhere around 200 to 300 thousand barrels per day lower than 2015 averages. The oil price obviously has a lot to do with the fact that you're seeing these important declines in oil production, but it is not the only reason. I'm going to go back to the first slide. Venezuela's oil production was already seeing declines even when oil prices were 100,000 barrels per day. In fact, Venezuela's oil production has seen from the 2008 to 2015 period about 500,000 barrels per day of decline. So oil prices it is a very important factor in explaining the declines, but it's not the only factor. And so and I think that the bulk of the issue really is about PDVSA's cash flow situation, or the strains in PDVSA's cash flow situation. What you have on the left is, at least my left, yes, it's PDVSA's operating income. I use the operating income results, not the overall results, because I want to take the financial gains out of that, which normally or can be a little bit misleading in showing exactly what the real cash flow situation of PDVSA is. And what we see is that since 2011, PDVSA has seen a continuous drop in its profitability. But at the same time, it has seen a continued increase in its transfers to the government, which means that PDVSA's profitability was declining, so too were the demands of the government to sustain to finance a very unsustainable economic model. The problem with that is that it led to a significant increase in debt. And PDVSA's debt pretty much increased by 100% in 4 years from the period of 2010 to 2014. And when you go into a debt surge of that magnitude, you know, there's always a payback. And so at some point, you have to pay this back. And so this is where we are right now, Venezuela's debt service. And that's why today's announcement, or last night announcement, that Venezuela or the PDVSA is engaging in a debt swap is so important, not only for bondholders, but for the the status or the situation of the oil sector in the country. If you look at, this is Venezuela, debt service per month. About a little bit less than 50% of Venezuela's total debt service this year is going to be paid between October and November. Actually, there's two bonds. PDVSA's 16 bond is paid. It's a $1 billion bond that has to be redeemed on October 28th, 4 days later. PDVSA has to redeem $2 billion from its PDVSA 17. That is $3 billion in 4 days. Just to give you an idea of what we're talking about, or what the what this represents for Venezuela's cash flow, if I just take the exports that I show you, about, let's say, 2 million barrels per day, and the average oil price of the Venezuelan basket, which is around $37 per barrel, that implies that Venezuela's monthly cash flow is about $2 to $2.5 billion per month. That's it. Venezuela's oil exports represent more than 94% of total exports. It doesn't really get any FDI. It's very limited financing. So let's assume that that's it. That's the wage that Venezuela gets on a monthly basis. So it means that Venezuela has to pay more in 4 days than what it makes in the whole month. So there you have it. I mean, that is why it's so important that this debt swap becomes successful, because it is having significant strains both on the Venezuelan economy, but also on the Venezuelan oil sector. You've probably heard or not the many news that have occurred in the last months about the oil service operators leaving Venezuela or significantly scaling down its operations because of arrears with the company. You've also had oil suppliers of PDVSA, for example, BP, which is won a tender to sell light oil to Venezuela. All of these are having important. The Venezuelan PDVSA are having important arrears with its oil service suppliers because the current cash flow situation of PDVSA, which pretty much is the cash flow situation of the country, is not enough. Not only to pay debt service, which every year is about $10 billion, but also to pay for the level of imports that Venezuela has. So the choice that Venezuela has made is that it pays the bond debt service payments, which are $10 billion, and whatever is left is the import. So if oil revenues fell by 50%, that's pretty much how much the oil, that's pretty much how much imports of everything has to fall for. So the choice of adjustment of Venezuela has actually become an important issue, and it's part of why we're in this predicament. If the debt swap that Venezuela is proposing, a debt swap which we actually do not know yet the details, but it pretty much entails swapping all of its 2016, the upcoming 2016 and 2017 amortizations for longer term duration type of paper. So that will, if significantly successful, it will ease tremendously the cash flow situation of PDVSA and probably of the country. If it doesn't, if it is not successful, then it will mean that the current cash crunch of PDVSA will accentuate, and that will also mean a more important decline of imports in the country in order to be able to meet the current almost $5 billion that PDVSA has to pay in the fourth quarter. So do you have an idea of why this is important also for the oil sector? PDVSA, or Venezuela, is not really an expensive oil producer, but it's migrating to a more expensive one. Why? Because the company and the country is doubling down on its very vast heavy oil resources that it has in the Orinoco Belt. The problem with these heavy oil resources, which are, the estimates are that it could be even larger than Saudi Arabia in terms of reserves, is that it's a very, very heavy type of oil that needs to be mixed with diluents or with light oil. If Venezuela is having declines in oil production, and most of these declines are actually coming from PDVSA's own oil production, and most of it is coming from conventional crude, what that means is that the availability of light oil in Venezuela is actually declining. With that, you also have that Venezuela has had a series of problems in its refinery system, and that has meant that there's less availability of diluents as well, in order to be able to use both of these to mix with these vast resources of very heavy oil, which need to be mixed. So given the decline or the lack of availability of sufficient diluents inside the country, Venezuela has had to resort to imports. And just let me show you the basket of Venezuela has changed. What you have seen, what you have in the green line is the API weighted gravity of Venezuela, and then you have the heavy oil increasing and the medium light condensates decreasing, which just tells you how the basket of crude in Venezuela is changing, and that has implications. Why? Because what Venezuela probably needs to do, it's actually now doing, and it's going to do increasingly more in the future, is that its bet on its heavy oil is also a bet on oil, light oil imports. In other words, in the future, for Venezuela to continue exporting oil, it will have to import oil. The imports of oil, in the current account numbers of the central bank, already represent an important part of the total imports of the country, and they're much more delicate, because if you don't import oil, then you're not going to be able to export oil. The composition of the basket, I think there's a consensus among local oil analysts that it's something between 75% Venezuela's basket versus 25% light oil or condensates or naphtha or whatever you use as a diluent. What that means is that in the current oil market environment, that adds about $10 to $12 per barrel to the cost of Venezuela's oil production. And so in a way, the marginal oil in Venezuela is a much more costly oil, and in the current environment means a barrel that yields a much less oil rent per barrel. And that is also problematic from the point of view of the current fiscal regime and the current regulatory regime. So what does this all mean for politics, which is also, I think, a very important part of the variable here? Wait. Is that Venezuela, it's not only the impact of the oil price on the economy, on the oil sector, but it is the way that Venezuela has adjusted to this to this collapse in oil prices and to this situation that has made matters much, much worse. There are other countries in the region that have seen significant depreciations of their currency, and just its neighbor, Colombia, did have a run-up of inflation of 10%, but that was it. Venezuela is seeing increases of inflation of about 7%, 8%, as measured by an NGO, of its family food basket, in which what you're seeing is that the current minimum salary is really not enough for people to be able to afford that basket of food. The government is making the economic situation much worse, and so it's not only not adjusting accordingly, it's actually contra-adjusting. It's doing the opposite of what it needs to be doing, and in a way, the economic policy decision-making is being sabotaged so that rational economic policy decisions are not being taken, but all of the economic decisions are being compromised at this moment. The more problematic thing is going more onto the political aspect of this, is that voters in Venezuela have been, have been clearly voicing their concerns, and you have the results in the first December 2015 elections, where the opposition won an overwhelming majority in the Congress. The government has moved as well to sabotage that process of at least political change that will bring about a change of economic policies. In this moment, voters and the opposition are moving to try to at least exert political change through a recall referendum, in which, if it's successful, could lead to elections if it's done before December 2016. So we are at a moment where an economic crisis, an oil crisis, a financial crisis now need a political, which also merged into a political crisis, needs the resolution of a political crisis to be able to solve the current conundrum. And this could be binary, both for Venezuela and for oil markets. If you have a political resolution in where you have a change of government that changes the current economic policy environment so that decisions are made on the macroeconomic front and on the oil policy front, then you can lead to a stabilization, maybe of oil production already at the end of 2017, if not by 2018. If on the contrary none of these things happen, what you're going to get is an acceleration, probably, of the current economic conditions and of the oil production and declines that we're seeing. However we want to see it, it doesn't seem that there's going to be a resolution in the near term, meaning that it's probably we're going to have to wait a couple of months before this happens. But what I would say is that two important things will be relevant in order to see where the oil production declines in Venezuela are going. First, what is going to happen with the debt, and therefore with the debt swap, because that will limit or constrain the PDVSA's cash flow situation and therefore its ability to produce and to export. And the second thing, whether there's going to be a political change in the country and what kind of political change, and whether this is going to lead to a process of economic policy making that will then put in place the right kind of policies in order to achieve a stabilization of oil. Those two equations, those two variables in this equation, are probably we're going to have a lot more visibility in the next months. Let me stop there.
Great. So thank you very much, Luisa. So I think you just raised a lot of very important questions. I would like to turn it over to Chris for a moment and ask. You know, Luisa clearly showed that the current crisis in the oil sector and the related humanitarian crisis was largely self-inflicted, largely driven by bad policy decisions and mismanagement over a long period before the price collapsed. And I would like to pick up on what she just said and ask you, you know, what's your view about the linkage between political leadership and potential for writing the course of economic policy? Do you feel that if there is a change of leadership, this will necessarily lead to an improvement in the management of the oil sector, and that could possibly sow the seed of recovery? Or conversely, if the regime manages to postpone the referendum until next year, is there any possibility that they might get the tools and fix the part of the problems without a change in leadership?
Well, I'd say several things. Good questions, Antoine. First, the first one is this regime capable of righting the ship? Can it do that? And I would say, and despite the fact, or because of the fact, that it has 700% inflation, perhaps, it's contracted by 7% last year, 10% this year, you do not have one economist in the cabinet. Not anyone with any credentials in economics. That probably makes sense. You'd be a fool to be an economist to take on this government. But what that means is I think the capacity of this government to correct course is severely limited. It has clearly broken the piggy bank when it comes to PDVSA. It's raiding PDVSA, using it for its own political projects. I think it's going to be very difficult for this government itself to change course. But there are also implications over the medium and long term. What this government is trying to clearly do by postponing the referendum, and Luisa alluded to this, is to have the referendum, if it happens at all, have it after January 10th, in which case the vice president would take over. And their hope is, they'll say on the sidelines, that hopefully the price of oil will have recovered somewhat and they can inject some more cash into the economy to keep it afloat. But it has dug itself into such a hole, I'm not sure that could happen. But let's assume the other scenario is that the referendum miraculously were held this year and the opposition took over, or that there is some sort of mediation, and that's really truly a optimistic scenario, that resulted in a coalition government. You have a number of problems. The first is what Luisa was alluding to very nicely, is that the quality of technocratic leadership within PDVSA has declined significantly, as has, because of the lack of investment in infrastructure, its productive capacity. So it's going to be very difficult to turn, to use perhaps a cutesy term, this oil tanker around any time in the short term to be able to address these production problems. So I hate to be, I'm normally not a pessimist, but to be honest, when you look at Venezuela and its short and medium term outcomes, it's difficult to be anything but a pessimist, even if there is a political change.
Adrian, what's your view on this? And also, you know, since the early days of the Chavez regime, I guess, there's been a lot of emphasis on pivoting away from the relationship with the U.S. and seeking other markets, other partners in China and Russia and elsewhere. How successful has that policy been, or unsuccessful? And what is the significance of Venezuela for the U.S. energy markets, and conversely, of the U.S. for Venezuela?
Thank you very much, Antoine. Well, first of all, let me address the issue of production. Under current conditions, obtaining accurate and timely Venezuelan production estimate is simply not feasible. OPEC publishes numbers from secondary sources and from direct communications with member countries. Secondary sources are not reliable. The variance of their estimate are very large, making the average level very difficult to gauge. On the other hand, self-declared OPEC numbers tend to reflect political objectives very clearly. In the case, it's not only the case of Venezuela, but particularly in the case of Venezuela, recent estimates of these two sets coincide in terms of trends, although the direct communication levels tend to be around 10% higher than secondary sources averages. In 2015, production seems to have stabilized. If you look at the numbers the best way you can. However, in the first two quarters of 2016, it contracted sequentially 2.8 during the first quarter, 2.8%, and 4.3% in the second quarter. Luisa alluded to the specific, the most recent number, and looked at it year on year. That probably exaggerates a bit the magnitude of the decline. But more importantly, let me concentrate on the Venezuelan exports. U.S. Venezuelan relations remind me of those couples that have been married for a long time, are deeply unhappy with each other, constantly bickering and fighting and not making up, but they continue to go to bed together. Paradoxically, in spite of everything, U.S. imports of Venezuelan crude oil have performed pretty well. They have fallen substantially from the peak they reached 20 years ago. However, in the 2000s, the year 2000s, up to 2007, they were stable over an 8-year period. And in the last 3.5 years, they have again tended to stabilize. In fact, Venezuelan crudes gained market shares in the US when imports were, in fact, falling. Let me focus on heavy crude imports into the US Gulf Coast, where they mainly compete with Mexican and more recently with Canadian crudes. This is by far the largest market for these types of crudes in the world. In the first half of 2016, these three countries had a joint market share of 71%. Mexico had to move the crude it was not able to sell in the Gulf to European and Asian markets, but it managed to maintain its U.S. market share in that period. Export from Canada fell dramatically after May 1st, when they had the fires in Alberta. Up to the first quarter of 2016, Venezuela gained market share. However, in the second quarter, it had a significant fall due mainly to the drought described by Venezuela. And I believe that it's still too early to say, although most probably it is the case, it is part of a more permanent trend. But I think one has to be cautious with respect to this. Now, what has managed to maintain that market share, among other things, is the fact that the Venezuela's adulterous episode with China seems to have simmered down, given the short-term cash requirements of Venezuela, which drove this country back to its more stable long-term partner. This partially explains the resilience of Venezuela's market share in the U.S. Gulf Coast. So, you know, I think we have to clearly things are going badly, but we also have to be cautious of not painting an overly drastic situation. I'm not trying to minimize what is happening, but I just think one should be careful because of the overall quality of the numbers and because of specific events that can distort the overall picture. Thank you.
Thanks, so that's great. Luisa, I was wondering if you could dig a little bit deeper in one issue that you touch on in your report. For all the problems that the industry is facing in Venezuela, it still relies on foreign partners. So foreign companies are still involved there, and new ones have been getting on the scene from emerging countries. And service companies have been critical to production. There's been many problems with paying the service companies. There's been a bit of a comedy act. They're leaving, they're staying, they're leaving again, they're coming back. So what's the status today? And how can foreign partners, IOCs, service companies deal with the crisis? What's the outlook there?
No, I even in the most of the nationalistic drive in Venezuela, there was always I think a clear understanding that partners in particularly in joint ventures in the Orinoco heavy oil belt were important. There was just a change in the ownership composition, so that PDVSA had the majority participation. But when looking at PDVSA's annual reports, what we see is that the production that is jointly managed in Venezuela, has held much better than the production that is managed only by PDVSA. The problem, which is I think good news, because if there needs to be a more dramatic changes in oil energy policy, you do have partners there, partners that have been there for a while. So you have the basis and the infrastructure, at least from a point of view of the oil companies, in order to ramp up production in the future. So I think that's actually a strength. The problem with that distribution is that the majority of the conventional crude in Venezuela, the medium and the medium heavy and the medium light, is managed by PDVSA only, and so it is that's where you're seeing the most important declines. To be fair, those are the oldest fields as well, both on the western side and the eastern side. All of the old ventures of PDVSA in the Faja, in the Orinoco oil belt, these are new, and thus that's the future of Venezuela. And that's why the composition of the basket is changing, because that's a much more heavy type of oil, of grades of between 8 to 12 API. And so I think that is a strength that the oil sector in Venezuela has. But it is probably one of the ways in which Venezuela will have to move forward in a more significant way if it wants to recover conventional crude. I want to have a little bit of comment on Adrian's points. The interesting thing about the data from direct communication is that that's the data of PDVSA. So I'm actually using the most optimistic data, and I actually think it's true. That data is probably pretty true from the point of view of PDVSA. So if they have a political objective of exaggerating the data, that data is telling you that oil production is declining more rapidly than we have seen in the past 10 years. The other thing is that, interestingly enough, PDVSA also started to report the ministry started to report also the data. And so now they reported July and they reported August. It's the same data that they're reporting to OPEC, which is interesting. So it's, I think it's actually stresses the point that that is a reliable data, at least as the data that PDVSA is working with. And so if it has biases, it's that's their data. I do think that, and I would agree, and I stress that in the report, the January May, the January June numbers, export numbers, that I actually I didn't take the tanker data. I went to the Chinese customs unions, to the Indian data reported by Reuters, and to the U.S. Energy Information Administration to look at what they're reporting the Venezuela exported to them. So. From that point of view, which is the point that I'm making, is that the export data has held pretty well. You actually see a ramp up in Venezuela's exports to China in 2016, and Venezuela's exports to India, and you see a decline of 3.5% in Venezuela's exports to the U.S. January June averages year on year. So we're starting to see. Those numbers, I'm looking at them from the point of view of the country that receives them. What I can see is that the trend from the point of view of the U.S., which is again is 15 days of tanker travel, so it's very immediate. It takes 45 days to get to China, so you know it's more inconsistency between the tanker data and the Chinese customs unions, but. What you're starting to see is that yes, there's an impact on oil exports, and that is real, and that is more important than what we saw in 2015. 2015, actually, Venezuela's oil exports were up, so that helped cushion the decline in oil in the decline in oil prices. On the political side, alluding to a comment. By Chris, I think you made a very good point, which is we are at a point where there's not only a political stalemate, it's that there's a policy stalemate. Yeah. It's that there's a freeze in when you look at what countries in the region and what countries in other parts of the world are doing with the collapse in oil prices. With the collapse in oil prices, normally you tend to have liberalization of oil fiscal regimes, of oil regulatory regimes. You have Mexico moving towards towards an auction process. You have Ecopetrol in Colombia selling assets both downstream and upstream. You have a more relaxing of the rules. So it's a cycle, right? Oil prices increase and you have a more important nationalization policies. Oil prices collapse and then you have the opposite. What it strikes me about Venezuela is the lack of change of any kind. And what I would say is that to me, the policy process is broken. And that's why political change has become is seen as the only solution to break that freeze in policy. I would agree that we don't know exactly what the outcome will be of this political statement. What I would say is that you are so far in this political crisis that a political stabilization is key in order to stabilize the economy and to stabilize, to me, the oil industry. I don't think that it's going to be that easy for the government just with an increase in oil prices. Yeah. To be able to stabilize the current conditions.
Is there a clear sense of who's actually in control of the oil policy in Venezuela? When Maduro came in after the death of Chavez, he seemed to be a more conciliatory figure than Chavez had been. He came from a different background. He was a union negotiator. He was not the leader of a military coup. He seems to be determined to attract the companies back in to make the investment climate more attractive and rekindle production growth, even before the price started collapsing in earnest. But he hasn't delivered. And is it because of a lack of vision, or is it because he's not really in control, and other parties in the leadership are blocking his moves?
I think there are a couple of things. I think there, the government is trapped kind of in an ideological, the ideology is functioning as a straitjacket, and I think that's becoming problematic. For example, there was one very interesting comment made by the CEO of PDVSA, in which he mentioned that maybe the nationalization process had gone a little bit too far, and they should have not nationalized all service providers. The rest of the Chavismo, he was significantly criticized by the rest of the of the ruling party. And you know, this is the person that actually, before becoming the CEO of PDVSA, was the person that handled the joint ventures. He was the head of CVP, which handles the joint ventures. So he's an old person. I do think that he understands quite well what needs to be done, at least. You know, from a general perspective, but I do think that it's not lack of willingness; it's just lack of political capacity to function within the existing framework. So I think it's that the political system was built for a very strong person, that was for a caudillo style person. So the caudillo style person leaves the structure, but without. With a leader without that kind of mandate. And so I think there's a part of what's going on within the government, that there is there's a problem with the decision-making process. That decision-making process has been captured by too many contradictory groups that is compromising rational economic policy decisions, correct diagnosis. And so the policy outcome is not ideal in the current circumstances, and it's making things, I think, much worse.
Mm-hmm. Is that your view as well, Chris?
Yeah, I would agree. I mean, some of the people that were in there originally who had more credibility, Ramirez and others, sort of have left, which has boiled it down to a more hardcore, I think, ideological group. I think Maduro, while he has a tendency, he as a union leader, maybe had more of a feel for negotiation. The problem is, in practice, as he feels more threatened, he acts more like a wounded animal than he does like a union leader, which is to sort of hunker down. And I think that's created exactly what Luisa was saying, that policy deadlock that has made it just basically two extremes, that's going to make it very difficult to resolve it in any consistent way. And again, this is a government that is really depending on any sort of increase in the price of oil to keep itself politically afloat. It's not looking at it as an economic benefit. I would just add one thing, too, which with the bonds, and I would be interested in hearing Luisa's thoughts on their potential success, the bond swaps. But the question, Venezuela has never defaulted, and they're very proud of that. But of course, they've got about $11.8 billion worth of reserves right now, about $10 billion coming up in payments in the next year and a half. You know, it's going to become a do-or-die moment. If those swaps don't work, what will they do? They could sell Citgo, which is sort of selling the crown jewels, or they may actually have to default. And that could have really massive ripple effects within just generally the Latin American economy. So I'm just curious your thoughts on that as well, if I can ask it.
I think one interesting thing about the default is that, or the way the Venezuelans look at debt, and specifically the government, is that it's very problematic for PDVSA to default. National companies do not default in general. I mean, there's very few instances of defaults of national companies. And I think I remember Pertamina in the 1970s in Indonesia, and it was a loan. It was not a bond. It's a very complicated process. And in Venezuela, for example, defaulted in the 1980s, and PDVSA never defaulted. PDVSA didn't have the kind of debt that it had at that moment. So there's no easy solutions here. If they pay, the impact of the credit problems that are coming from arrears to service providers are also having operational effects. If they don't pay, it's even worse. And so they're in a very difficult situation. I think the problems that the way they see this is that if or the way I think the government sees it is that if they default, it's almost automatically regime change because they perceive that their account receivables in the U.S., for example, could be seized, their tankers could be seized. Whether that is true or not, that's a different thing. but they have, it's much less under their control. And they think that then the cash flow situation then becomes very, very problematic because then they don't have access to dollars. Or there's a risk that they don't have access to dollars at all, regardless of how that risk, if that risk is immediate or not. But I think the understanding is that the consequences of that default could be much higher than the current situation in which you are adjusting imports in a drastic way and that you're having operational impact, regardless of whether you default or not, the operational impact of your credit crunch is being felt at this moment. So it's a difficult situation. Yeah. What we know about the debt swap currently is that this is probably, I mean, they have about $7 billion in debt amortizations coming in 2017 between the PDVSA 2017 sinkable bond and the PDVSA 2017 that matures in April, which are, the two together are $7 billion. So they want to exchange that for a 2020 bond, which seems to me that it could be a sinkable bond, but I don't know the terms. They do seem to want to have CITGO as some kind of guarantee. I'm not very clear on that either, because CITGO already issued notes and has loan facilities, all of which are guaranteed with CITGO's assets. For example, two of the notes, one of the CITGO notes has 49% of CITGO Petroleum Corporation, which owns all the refineries, and has guaranteed as assets all the storage facilities and terminals. The other CITGO notes has guaranteed the refineries. So I'm not very clear what exactly are they putting as guarantee. I know that there's going to be an equity, they're going to put equity shares in CITGO. I'm not sure exactly what. But CITGO is already not only levered, but its assets have been put into guarantee. So I'm not clear what the worth of that guarantee that they want to put to sweeten the deal will be.
So like a second mortgage on a house.
It's a second mortgage on the house, yeah. So I'm not clear on that. I think then the terms of the debt swap will have to be very, very attractive, meaning that it will have to be a high coupon and probably pay more than the capital that they're redeeming. So 2 times or 1.5 times the capital. So, which means that this debt swap will be very expensive. Yeah. And so the question is, will it reduce or not the risk of default? Probably will reduce the risk of default in a very near term. But if this is a hedge on oil prices going up after 2018, then it's not that problematic from the point of view of longer term. It's not clear. It's not clear. What is clear is that the risk of default will fall or not depending on the level of participation that they obtain. And the level of participation that they obtain will significantly depend on the terms that they present. So this is could be an important moment for Venezuela's credit.
I want to open it up for questions from the audience in just a second, but before I do that, I just have a last question. The other side, I mean, there's the internal dynamics working against Venezuela, the management problems, but there's also the oil price problem. And this is not the first time the oil market has a downturn. Back in 97, 98, there was also a very dramatic plunge in the oil price. And at that time, Venezuela was able to team up with others, and Adrian here was a participant in those discussions as the head of PEMEX. There was an accord between the Mexicans, Venezuela, Saudis, and Iranians had a thaw at that time under Khatami's presidency in Iran and Crown Prince Abdullah in Riyadh. So there was an agreement that engineered production cuts that successfully actually led to a recovery in the oil price. And when you watch Venezuela today, there seems to be a lot of hope that production cuts could be again engineered and lead to a recovery, but the market has changed. The Middle East is unrecognizable from what it was 10 years ago. So I'm curious what you feel, and also Adrian, since you were there and you wrote a fascinating first-hand account of those discussions back in 98 in the publication of the Oxford Institute for Energy Studies just recently. How do you think, what are the chances of Venezuela influencing other OPEC members or other members of the market?
I don't see that happening, Antoine. As you mentioned before, circumstances today are dramatically different from those that prevailed in the late 1990s. And I don't really see Venezuela given its own conditions, I don't see Venezuela having any leverage whatsoever in terms of global negotiations. You know, they will make noise from time to time, but I don't think they're a credible player in terms of market stabilization. Now, mind you, production is falling, so they don't even have much to offer in that respect. But, you know, clearly from reading Luisa's paper and from what has been said today here at this table, it can easily be concluded that things are going to get much worse, much, much worse before they begin to improve. Now, Luisa was very careful, very cautious, and she totally eludes the discussion of what might be the nature of the end game that is being played out, or the long-term path of to eventual recovery. Obviously, both questions, the end game and recovery, are extremely difficult to say anything intelligent about today, given all of the uncertainties. Now, as time passes, I find it more and more difficult to envisage a smooth transition to some form of more democratic and more competent political regime. A full collapse of the Bolivarian regime will most probably involve even deeper economic, Luisa has been describing some of this, economic and financial crisis, and I'm afraid to say some form of constitutional discontinuity. If this turns out to be the case, it is even more difficult to say much about the eventual pattern of recovery. It depends very much on the depth and of the crisis and on the strength and stability of the new regime. That's why I think it's important at this point to really start to think hard. First of all, about the potential production disruption effects that all of this politically complex situation might come about. We have to really, first of all, think about what might be the volumes involved. Is it going to be a total collapse and production, you know, goes to half of what it is today? Or what sort of production disruption will take place? Second, the timing. And the timing is important not only internally in Venezuela, but internationally, in terms of how it impacts the global market. There's the duration of the interruption. It can be a couple of months, but it could be much longer. And of course, the expectations that are generated in all of this will have a very important impact on how we all see the impact of Venezuela, or the potential impact of Venezuela on global markets. There we have to be looking at the magnitude of the spare capacity at the time and the level of stocks, of course. But that's at the global level. I think what we have to do, and especially I'm sure people in this country are doing, in the oil industry, is looking more specifically at the Gulf of Mexico heavy crude oil market and the conditions that might prevail. Remember, as I mentioned before, it is the largest market for heavy crude oil. It's a very important market. It's a massive market. And it has very specific characteristics in terms of the hardware of the refineries in the U.S. Gulf Coast, in terms of the types of crudes that they normally process. So there we also have to look at the Canadian, Mexican, and other Western Hemisphere alternatives. What alternatives are there? Production in Mexico is also declining. So there won't be that much relief unless Mexico brings crude oil that it is today selling in Asia and in Europe back to the U.S. Gulf Coast, and that might be an option. Also Canada. I mean, the pipelines. We really have to look hard at pipelines to see how much heavy crude oil can actually flow from the Western Canada to the U.S. Gulf Coast. And there are other Western Hemisphere alternatives, not only in terms of heavy crudes. There's Brazil, there's Colombia. There are other sources of heavy crude oil. But then, in terms of all of this, the response times are very important. What sort of response times are we going to have from the various players in such an event? The other important topic, I think, and I insist, it's, and that's even more difficult, is the likely time scale of the recovery. First of all, you have to break the production inertia, which is taking you in one direction up till now. Then you have to restructure PDVSA to be able to have any production response. After that, you know, you're going to mobilize international investment into the Venezuelan oil industry. Again, it's not a two-day event. It's a long period of time that we're talking about. It's a very complex lag structure from investment decisions to production. And in a situation of great turmoil, like the one that one could envisage, it might be very difficult to make any predictions. You're dealing with, most probably, with large-scale, complex, and lengthy development projects in the Orinoco Basin. I don't see much taking place on the eastern side of Venezuela. I'm sorry, on the western side of Venezuela, in Maracaibo. So it's really the Orinoco, and those are really large-scale projects. And finally, we're really talking about, and not in years, it will take years for production to begin to recover. Now, within that time frame, years, it can be a couple of years or it could be more. So I think one has to be prepared to think that the recovery will be relatively slow. I want to remind you that in some cases, Iran, Iraq, it hasn't yet recovered to the previous regime levels. In the case of Iran, after many, many years. So in Venezuela, it could take a number of years for crude oil to recover, crude oil production to recover.
I want, I think, to open it up for questions. If anybody has a question, perhaps we were supposed to have a microphone here, but just, oh, there's one running around. So Julie, can, if you can bring it, thanks.
Thank you. Is this on?
Yeah.
Jason Fargo with Energy Intelligence. I'd like to actually riff off Adrian's comment just now about the fact that it might take several years to restore production in Venezuela to get a recovery. I was wondering if you could elaborate a bit on that. I mean, I've seen that even, you know, on its own, PDVSA has been talking at least publicly about doing a lot of enhanced oil recovery projects in Maracaibo to sort of reactivate wells that have been shut in. People that I've spoken with, both in the private sector and also within the U.S. government, sort of suggest that you could see a rapid turnaround from that area within, you know, a shorter time frame than the two or plus years that you were talking about, if there's investment. I mean, certainly there are a lot of, you know, small independent companies that have kind of gotten involved in other countries, you know, mature oil fields. We've seen some of these companies going into Mexico, for example. I mean, can you talk a little bit more about why you don't see the traditional regions in Maracaibo sort of coming back?
Before any investment, international investment, comes back into Venezuela, the type of investment environment that you have to create won't be an easy matter. You will, you know, have to set up a new regulatory regime, clearly, to really incite a number of players to come in. And if that doesn't happen, after a major political collapse and financial and economic collapse, it is very difficult, I think, to move quickly. I mean, there's no technical fixes to this problem. This problem is essentially a political one. It's a regulatory problem. And reconstructing all of this over time is not going to be an easy matter. It will take a lot of time. Whoever thinks that there's easy technical fixes, I think, has no idea of the nature of the problem.
If I could just add something to that, not as an energy person, but as a political scientist, you know, I think it's difficult, almost impossible, for those who focused on the region to understand the depth of the deinstitutionalization of the Venezuelan state, the extent to which it's been politicized and corrupted. And what Adrian is saying is true, is that that has implications in terms of regulatory frameworks, in terms of how you attract investment. I think that it's difficult to, it's an intangible, but it's very difficult to imagine how you could turn that corner quickly.
But I'm sorry, the system you say has been corrupted over these years. It was corrupted before Chavez. The reason Chavez came into power was because there was a previous collapse of the Venezuelan political system. Otherwise, Chavez wouldn't have.
But I'm not justifying the previous system, but I do think PDVSA has lost hundreds of technocrats and engineers.
No
to
doubt. My only point is that it's a longer term process that we're dealing with, and that is what also makes it more difficult.
I think that Adrian's point that I avoid going too much in depth in the report exactly for the reasons he mentions is that politics is going to be essential to understanding, because this is a very different story than other stories in the region. This is not a, if there's going to be a regime change, it's not going to be a very clean process, because there's not a presidential election clearly there. So, and there's a lot of, and as Chris is mentioning, there has been a lot of institutional destruction that has taken place in the past couple of years, in the past years. So we there's actually a lot of unknowns about the extent of how solid institutions are going to be, if there is or not regime change. What kind of regime change is that? Is that a regime change that will have governability? Is that a regime change that, what does that look like in terms of stability? There are many questions about that. What I would say is that, to me, because there are many scenarios, I avoided talking too much about them, just to say that politics to me is a binary outcome. If you have a scenario where the rosy scenario, which is possible, in which this process of pushing for a recall referendum ends up in an election and a mandate for a new president in the context of an opposition Congress, which exists and that is working on energy laws, for example, there is a room for stabilization of oil production. There's room for construction. There's a scenario for that. But I think what Adrian is alluding to is that there's so much uncertainty around exactly the type of scenarios that could evolve. We actually don't know. I am more optimistic about the probabilities of that more rosy political scenario or more constructive political scenario. But I'm completely cognizant that there are many scenarios with many outcomes, and if you do not have political stability, it's very difficult to achieve either stabilization or even increases in production. I'm very clear on that, and I think that's the point that he's making. He's using, you know, other cases, other countries, oil producing countries, where that was not achieved, that kind of a political stability and institutional stability was not achieved, and it was very difficult to get to those levels. We don't know where we're dealing with in Venezuela. I think that's one of the big question marks. I tend to believe that the probability that the scenario of, for example, oil production stabilization in 2 years, if there is an election with a new candidate that has a mandate in the context of an opposition government, with a Congress that is also opposition, in the context of a regulatory system which allows you already a lot of private sector participation, and where private sector companies are already in place, and where there's been a lot of institutional destruction, and including in PDVSA, but probably the oil institutional framework is the best in the country, relatively speaking, which is not to say much, but that there could be, that process might not be as dramatic. Let me put it this way.
Thanks. I think what you said, Adrian, about the response time is also a very important point, which is underestimated by the market. We saw it back in 2002, 2003, during the general strike at PDVSA. It was very difficult to replace those barrels. I mean, there was a response from Saudi Arabia at the time, but it took several weeks to make a decision to replace the barrels, and then the sailing time was a multiple of the very short haul sailing time between Venezuela and the Gulf Coast. And that was a time when there was a lot of spare capacity in the system. So today it's a much tighter market, even though there's a huge overhang of stocks and it looks like the market is oversupplied. There's actually a lot less spare capacity and a lot less flexibility to replace Venezuelan barrels in a way. And I think the immediate response will have to be from storage, but we don't know how much heavy oil is in storage. There's a question here in the back. Yeah.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Lucia Martin. I'm a SIPA alumni, and currently I'm working as a country economist for Venezuela at the Inter-American Development Bank. And congratulations on the paper, and thank you for the presentation. My question for Luisa is, if we think about an optimistic scenario where the bond swap is successful, what do you think is going to be the impact of this on the production? Or rephrasing the question, what would be the level of investment you need to keep the production, the oil production? My second question is, if there has been or there are going to be any spillovers from the decreasing production in Venezuela in the global price? And my third question, if you allow me, is what is your opinion about the oil that is being diverted to smuggling? There are some officials that say that it's about 100,000 barrels per day, but I don't know if this has changed because there are not official estimations. Thank you.
I think the oil smuggling is much less of an issue this year than it was last year, in part because there was a closure of the border with Colombia, and that probably eased, I don't know what the numbers are, by the way, but I do think that because there was a clear closure of the border, that should have been, because it impacted everything else, it should have impacted legal trade, it should have impacted illegal trade as well. The decrease, I think it's more counterfactual. There's a declining trend in oil production in Venezuela just because of the significant strains in the cash flow of PDVSA. If the debt swap is not successful, then it is going to weigh even more importantly on the existing cash flow situation of PDVSA. And could, if it's not successful, could accelerate, for example, the production declines in the future, just because it means that there's even less money for CapEx. So the rig count, for example, is already falling. And so that already tells you that there's not a lot of money being put into action. So the way it works is that the strains on PDVSA cash flow put strains on the ability to invest. And in an oil sector, you have to invest just to keep production, let alone to increase it. So I think it's more that if it's not successful, that probably could accelerate. It's a risk of accelerating the oil production declines because there will be even less money for any kind of maintenance, for example, work. So that's what I would say. So for the debt swap it will be important to ease the current restrictions on imports, but not a lot. I mean, we're talking that even in the context of, even with the current cash flow situation of the country, where you have, let's say, between $2 to $3 billion, you have to pay everything, including debt service, and you're just going to smooth out the amortizations. You still have to pay the debt service, but the amortizations are a big chunk. So I would say that could ease somewhat. The significant import restraints that are taking place. If it's not successful, it will make them worse, which means that the inflation, scarcity, the GDP contraction will be worse. And so if it goes through, then it just doesn't make things worse. It probably maybe just keeps it as it is.
Garfield Miller from Aegis Energy Advisors. To whom, I mean, you've talked about how important this debt swap is. To whom does Venezuela or PDVSA owe this debt? And what's their incentive to participate in a swap if they anticipate radical regime change that may be lead to a regime that might repudiate whatever agreements they currently have in place? I mean, they might be, don't know if they'd be weakening their position, but I'm just curious if there's a concentration of ownership of any of this debt and what their particular interests might be.
I don't think there's a perception that a change of regime will repudiate the debt. I think there's the perception that if there's a change in regime, that will lead to a significant increase in bond prices just because it could unblock the current policy stalemate that exists. So I think the perception right now is either it doesn't change and we stay with the current ruling party, which it's clear to everyone that has a huge willingness to pay at the cost of an economic contraction and social and political unrest, which is even more problematic. But what I think the current understanding it will be that if you do have regime change, it will make the situation or it will potentially increase the recovery value of the current bonds, and that will make it more probable that people will participate. But who's carrying the debt exchange is not the new government. It's not a new government. It's the current government. And so even if there's some probability or there's a probability that there could be regime change in 2017, there's such uncertainty about exactly what that means, if there is or not, what are the conditions, what is the stability. So it's you actually have to take the current offer in a way with the current conditions in place. And so it has to be more a bet on oil and with the probability, some probability that there's regime change, but it has to be more a bet on oil than it is about politics. Because it's the current bondholders that have the PDVSA 2017 that matured in this quarter and next year. The incentives will completely depend on whether there's on net present value evaluations. Because if it's clear because there's no threat of default, and it's been very clearly spelled out that this is a voluntary debt exchange. Bondholders have complete, free will to decide, no, I just want my money. On November 2nd, I want my money, period. In other debt exchanges, in the emerging market world, some of these countries that are in a distressed situation have taken the route that, we're going to do a distressed debt exchange in which is going to be you can exchange this bond for other bonds that might have a 10% value loss, but there's a threat of default, so the participation has been high. For example, Uruguay, Ukraine, there have been examples of that. This is a corporate debt exchange, not really a sovereign debt exchange. It is not as easy to do exchanges to change the conditions of the exiting bonds for the current bondholders, so that makes it more difficult or makes the incentives for entering into a debt exchange less obvious, which is why there's so much uncertainty about if this debt exchange is going to be successful or not. And what does success mean? What is the government really, what is the measure of success for the government? 50%, 30%, 20%? If this is a voluntary debt exchange, what is the measure of success? To me, a debt exchange will have to be, particularly for it to be successful, it will have to reduce significantly the PDVSA April 2017 bond, which is coming due. Because at least from the point of view of the financial markets, it does seem that the news flow and both Adrian and you can talk about this, but there's this perception in the market that the $40 to $50 range for oil prices is going to be here for longer than we thought. There's this perception, coming in the past couple of weeks, is there has been this perception that the rebalancing is going to take a little bit longer. And so if that is the case, I think that reduces the incentives for the debt exchange, for example. And so, and that puts more problems into the fourth quarter, into the first half of the year, of next year, debt payments. And so I think there are a lot of moving parts. There are a lot of variables. Probability of regime change is one. Where oil prices are going to be when this bond debt matures is another one. What the success of the debt exchange itself will be. There's collective action, I think, issues among the bondholders as well. So, I mean, there's a lot of uncertainty.
There's time for a few more questions, maybe two or three maximum, with short answers. And if anybody online has a burning desire to ask a question, the hashtag is CGP events, and the Twitter handle is @ColombiaUEnergy.
Hello, panels. My name is Patrick. I'm actually a graduate student from the Chemical Engineering School. And you, during the speech of Ms. Palacios, you mentioned that it would actually take a lot of time in order for the whole economy to establish in Venezuela. So what I'm in, as you guys probably aware of, right now we're moving, well, as a society, we're moving into a more cleaner kind of energy. So what do you think, does that gonna make in the long term of impact in terms of, since Venezuela is gonna take like a lot of time in order to kind of establish their export, so how do you think is that gonna actually affect?
Yeah, okay. Let's take a few questions at the same time. That will give more room for people to ask questions.
Okay.
Jim.
Wonderful presentation. My name is Jim Arrowsmith. Wonderful presentation, wonderful discussion. I have a question. Is there any figure lurking in the background who might be able to replace, in one way or another, the existing president and existing government? A great man, as it were, or woman.
Yes, my name is Christian Merck at APCO Worldwide. I'm interested in Venezuela's relationship with China. Recent press reports have said that China's current outstanding debt is only $20 billion, which would indicate a substantial amount of their loans have actually been repaid, which would be interesting. And they've also indicated the Chinese have decided they won't make any new investments or future loans. And I wonder if you could comment on those reports, and specifically, do you think there's any possibility that there could be material new financial support for the industry coming from the Chinese?
Maybe there's room for one quick other questions, or no? Okay. So, Luisa, please.
Okay, let me start with China. Yes, the current outstanding stock of Chinese debt is about $20, $25 billion. It's, and the reason is that the way Chinese loan to Venezuela has been normally, because they've changed the terms, is a three-year loan agreement in which China prepays for future oil and is paid back in 3 years. So, and you have three of those. So each of those matures in 1 year, and then it gets renewed, and then another one matures. So you actually, you keep the stock of debt constant, and what you do is you pay with debt service. Venezuela, for example, PDVSA in its financial reports, one of the things that that you can see very clearly is this is how much we sold the Chinese. This is how much we had to pay for debt service. So implicitly, you actually can assess how much of the barrels are going for debt service. It's about, the last year was about 330,000 barrels per day of the almost 600,000 barrels per day that they shipped to China. The loans both, they have a loan agreement, but then you have a commercial agreement, and you commit yourself to sell X amount of barrels, of which some of which are going to be just paid for debt service, but the others are going to be paid in full. The Venezuelans began a discussion of debt restructuring with the Chinese already. And so they, because there's the Chinese debt service gets paid with oil, given the collapse in oil prices, that implies that Venezuela's oil shipments to China have to significantly increase to service the same amount of debt. And that's a problem if you have a declining oil production. And so what the Venezuelans have been trying to do with the Chinese is to restructure the capital amortizations part of the debt so that they receive more money for their oil shipments. And so from the Chinese perspective, this is already a country that has payment issues. As far as I understand, the three-year loans, which are now some of them are not 3 years but longer, do not get renewed unless they're fully paid. And so that will put limits to renewing again one of the next tranche. So I'm not clear how much more money is coming from the Chinese because these loans have not been repaid. I've always seen the Chinese as suppliers of last resort, not lenders of last resort of Venezuela. And I think that's the case. I think they have a limit to how much. I mean, they're not going to save. They do have interests, and we see them in the way they negotiate with Latin American countries. They have clear interest in the way they contract their loans.
Great figure. The
figure existing. There's not a clear, not a clear figure. I think the way I see the political system in Venezuela is that a lot of political actors are positioning for a transition without knowing exactly what kind of political transition there's going to be. You do have a recall referendum, and the recall referendum is, what it does is that there's a figure in the constitution in Venezuela that you can recall with a vote the current, any elected official, and if you do that before completing half of its mandate, then it leads to election. To me, the recall referendum has taken a life of its own. I think there's overwhelming majority of Venezuelans that want an electoral solution to the current political crisis. What that means to me is that the most stable political solution, Venezuela right now is in an unstable political equilibrium. So how do you move that to a stable political equilibrium? To me, is that somehow the stabilization of politics will probably require elections because you need a new mandate for somebody that all voters have to agree on. One of the legacies of the Chavismo is that Chavez did elections for everything. Every year there was elections. So I think that is a legacy of after 15 years of elections. I think the Venezuelans that's why it's very difficult not to have elections in Venezuela, even if the current government is trying to become more authoritarian. It's very difficult not to have elections because that's a legacy of the Chavismo. And even the Chavistas want elections, the Chavistas non-Maduristas. So I think that a stable political solution for me in Venezuela is one that ends up in election at some point, because that will give somebody else a new mandate. So there's not an obvious person, because there's not one person that can guarantee stability in Venezuela. It's a process that will guarantee stability in Venezuela.
I think we're bumping against our time limit, so we have to continue the discussion offline. I just want to, as mentioned, remind you that a full video recording is going to be available on the website and also audio recording in just a few days. You can also subscribe to our podcast series on iTunes, Stitcher, SoundCloud, and other platforms. And tonight is just one of the many great events that the center is organizing. And the next one, September 26th, one of the next ones, is going to be about LNG markets in transition. There's going to be a book launch. So we hope to see you again soon. Thanks very much for coming tonight and joining us. And please join me in thanking our speakers one last time.